Yeah, so AI Film Festival was born out of the necessity to finance our indigenous projects that do not make money. It was born out of the need to make a film festival that was not controlled by one of the top five competitors in this field, so that all five of them have a level playing field to perform at. And it was born out of the necessity to because our promise is not just a film festival. We're not just a film festival. When you buy our ticket or when you come to our film festival, then you leave a filmmaker. That's the promise.
Hello, welcome to one more episode of 01 Cast. Today we had Asad Ayub. He is the organizer of the Amsterdam AI Film Festival, which is happening 21 of June in Amsterdam. Me and Mauricio, we were going to be there. I will also be part of one of the discussions. And yeah, the festival will be very interesting. We are looking forward for it. But we were not here just talking about the festival. We'll talk about future of jobs, we talk about creativity, many other things. So yeah, Mauricio, what's your take on it?
Hello, yeah, today's episode was really interesting. Yeah, he's a super guy focused on like opening companies and doing social good and helping like indigenous tribes and people that are in need. So I think there's a lot of interesting points on the today's talk that I really can make us think a lot, and he has a quite interesting take on the future with AI on it. So yeah, hope you all like.
All right, so let's go to the episode. Hello, welcome to one more episode of 01 Cast, place where humans create and machines dream. Today we have with us Asad Ayub. He's one of the organizers of the Amsterdam AI Film Festival. So yeah, I also hope I pronounce his name correctly. So yeah, we are here for a chat, not just about the festival, but about creativity, about filmmaking, about the job market, and many other things which are relevant to everything that's happening now. So Asad, would you first please give a short intro about yourself, or for people who are listening or watching, to know a bit more?
Yes, of course. Hi, my name is Asad. I'm one of the co-founders of the AI Film Festival Amsterdam. This is basically a project of the Mad Hatter Foundation, which is the nonprofit that is hosting the AI Film Fest. Before I started doing AI films, how I got into this was because I was a musician. We were a group of musicians looking to make music videos to get more engagement. And basically, yeah, so our heart is really in the sound and the sound design. And that's how we got into AI film, just making music videos, and then just fell down a rabbit hole from there. So yeah, that's a quick introduction about myself.
That's very interesting. Me and Mauricio, we are also musicians, and the first AI film I did was also a music video for my band, and was like totally experimental, and that like also drags me into the rabbit hole. So I think we are quite similar story here, and like I'll just like to drop a question which I drop for everyone on this podcast, which is before we talk about AI, talk a little bit about the Asad before AI. So how was your life? How was your routine? What you were doing, or like, yeah, or even your career before AI, and how did it change after AI?
Well, that's an interesting question. So the story starts in 2011. I'm doing my bachelor's. I'm in my second year. I start my first business. It is a social enterprise, a business which has a social mission and a purpose. It was to revive the sort of, at the time in Pakistan, there were quite a few things that were wrong, that were going on. Like, for instance, there was a war in Afghanistan, there was a lot of terrorism, there was a dengue fever thanks to climate change that had found our way to our country for the first time, which we had never sort of experienced
before. We had a lot of this in Brazil. It's very it's problematic. Yeah,
indeed, it's the same story. It was a Sri Lankan airplane where one passenger came, and then it became an epidemic thanks to the changing climate. So it was around that time that I was at home, and there was some kind of ethnic clash going on between my ethnicity, which is originally Indian, and another ethnicity from Pakistan. And people were getting killed in the street for looking like me. And that's when I came up with sort of this idea that we need to have a media force in Pakistan where something positive is said on the news, because there was a map of Pakistan with dengue mosquitoes flying on the left, US drones flying on the right, bombing the border, and terrorists, quote unquote, violating sovereignty, national sovereignty. So yeah, this is 2008, 2011. It's a crazy time, and that was my first enterprise. And ever since then, I have been involved in the field of a social enterprise. And specifically, after 2 years of setting up my own business, we landed up a grant for 350,000 euros from the MasterCard Foundation in 2013 to run a center for social innovation in Pakistan, the first social enterprise incubator, so an incubator for business that are for social good. But also profitable, so not like NGOs. That's a bit my story. From 2013 to 17, I was a partner for the Social Innovation Lab. After that, I came for my master's because when I started the Social Innovation Lab, I hadn't even graduated from my bachelor's, so they didn't give me the director position because that we partnered with my university and that those were the rules. So I came to get a master's from Germany for that reason in 2017. I spent the last six, seven years in Germany and arrived here last summer after spending a long time working again with social enterprises, social enterprise incubators funded by the European Union. So yeah, that's my story before. This is I would like to call my professional sort of trajectory. On the side, I've always had some consulting businesses going on. So in Germany, we had a consulting business, me and a bunch of friends. It was me and three brothers. We started a consultancy firm where they were the tech people, and I was the UX, UI kind of guy, and the idea guy, and the design thinking guy. So I've always been right next to technology. And also for artistic reasons and stuff, because I was a musician and I used to use these knobs and faders and everything. I tried to get into, I think in 2018, in 2020, in February, we were about to prototype something from China, which was like gloves where you can use hand gestures instead of knobs and faders and other expressive things like fire. You bring fire close to it and the volume increases and decreases, or light or wind or plant vitals. So that's what I was working on with this one device that is sort of like it translates the elements of the wind and sunlight and humidity into music, into, you know, like into control of individual tracks of synths, and the heartbeat of a human was going to be the drumbeat of the whole thing. And it was a sort of a crazy thing that I learned a lot of IoT knowledge for, how to use chips to sort of make all of these things possible. But I always depended on someone who had coding knowledge to bring my ideas to life. And before that, when I had the magazine, my very first business, I tried to start a comic book division, which didn't take off. A lot of things took off, like the documentary studio, et cetera, but the comic book studio did not take off. And that was something of a passion project of mine. And all these years later, just like I've always needed a coder, I've always needed an illustrator. And now, thanks to all of these technologies, me as a writer, I can storyboard my entire film myself. Me as an aspiring animator or filmmaker can actually bring my concept to somewhat to life. And that is extremely exciting. So yeah, I always wanted to make films when I was younger, and it was always a goal of mine. I thought, first music, then I'll learn how to draw, and then I will animate it myself Disney style and draw each and every, and paint each and every background. But then this came along and, you know, everything changed. So yeah, that's my story.
Thank you for this this story. It's very, very interesting. Many things, a lot of experience I think you had in many different fields as well. And since you said that how you have this potential to bring your ideas to life, so do you think that AI enhances or replaces human creativity? And for you, what are the potential pros and cons of creating with AI?
Well, I think my story in itself has the biggest con in it. So for instance, the biggest pro in it, which is that I had a 15-year timeline from the point where I, let's say in 2020 or something, a 10-15-year timeline in which I had 5-year goals and stuff, where I was going to learn how to animate myself because I wanted to work on my passion projects. Much like yourself, for you know, where you got those paintings of the indigenous people painted yourself, and you had this project lying in the background. What is it called? You know the one, right?
Green Hackers one.
Yes, Green Hackers.
Ah, the Green Hackers. Exactly. I was not sure if we're talking about 01 Senior or the Green Hackers.
No, I was talking about that. So indeed, so it was the Green Hackers project. So it was exactly like that. So I had a lot of these ideas. My plan was, and this is like 10 years ago or 15 years ago, this is like 2011. And I have a little division that didn't work out in the whole sort of my first business. And this was my passion project. I wanted to make a graphic novel, not because I was in love with graphic novels, but because it was going to be my storyboard for eventually what would be my film. And over the years, say, let's say 10 years later, I got really into sort of, you know, over the next 10 years, I got into sound design, really crazy into sound design and music. And yeah, so I think I was on my way and on my journey. And the next step was to learn how to animate. Now, of course, you know, in the story, there's a bittersweet kind of element there too, because here where I would have learned to actually draw something, which is a skill. Now, probably I wouldn't ever need to unless in a sort of, let's say, frivolous way. Like, it's just purely for luxury. It has no other value. It's only for my own joy. It's like cycling towards the sunset in the evening. You're not getting chores done. You're not going to work. So that's what the role of creativity is going to be. It's going to be therapeutic. It's going to be for oneself. But will you be able to sell these skills? I don't know. I mean, I guess I'll put it this way. Why would a company pay 50,000 euros a year for a low entry level graphic designer when they can get the same or equal quality in a 10 euro subscription? So this is just basic capitalism. It's not going to work. So anyway, I'm not in a sort of a doomer kind of a place, because in my story, you can also see the pros of this, which is it expedited my timeline. So my timeline of 5-10 years of first learning in a very slow way how to animate things, etc., etc., the amount of time and money it would have taken me to finally prove to people my direction skills or my ability to direct or tell a story, because that's the point of all of this, is to do the cave paintings that our ancestors did. It's storytelling. It's the oldest possible way of entertainment. And yes, so I think when you look at it as storytelling and not film or a particular career, then yes, it's a win for humanity. But when you look at, say, I like giving this example. So my sister did graphic design and she did it for 5 years. She has yet to graduate. And I really wonder, I mean, with how good, natural language processing has gotten, how good DALL-E 2 has already gotten, and with Sora. So if we only need natural language to code, if we only need natural language to make videos, if we only need natural language to make images, then yeah, what value do those skills of Photoshop really bring us anymore? You know?
Yeah, I think it always has its two sides, right? for both things. And but I think from the other side, like, is these skills like Photoshop and all the illustrative skills and everything is really like, it can be a commodity, something that you just want because it's a pleasure for you, but it can also be like the way you generate new things, you create new things, you know what I mean? Like, you do your work using AI, but then you create new art and new expressions using this old techniques, let's call it. And for me, the biggest problem about like the AI part of being communication, simple language communication to be the way to operate, is it's completely flawed. Like, language and like alphabet is incredibly limited. That's why we created art and music and all these kind of things to express ourselves as better than just with words, you know what I mean?
So go beyond the language, right?
Yeah. So I think that's a quite interesting point, because I think what type of language of communication we need to develop or elevate to like better operate AI just with language, you know what I mean? But I think it's a really interesting point, like, to remove the barriers of like have to learn a skill to build something. So yeah, I'm 100% with you on that. I'd like to talk a little bit about the entrepreneur side of your career, especially with the Mad Hatter and the AI Film Festival, which you are a board member in both companies. I'm especially curious about Mad Hatter and like what the company can do and in terms of plans for the future, and what is the experience to be part of a company like that?
Yeah, for sure. So Mad Hatter Foundation is a foundation that exists to further Industry 4.0 education, education regarding Industry 4.0. Then you would ask, what is Industry 4.0? So because it's kind of like a buzzword. So Industry 4.0 was a term coined by the head of the World Economic Forum. I think his name is Klaus Schwab. I'm sorry. But yeah, I think it is definitely Klaus Schwab. So yeah, the head of the World Economic Forum wrote a book, I think a couple of years ago, maybe 6 years ago, something like this, in which he said that we have a new paradigm, a new kind of industrial revolution that's going on. And in that industrial revolution, he included certain technologies that he said were going to sort of lead the way to the future. And of course, it had data and all of these things in it, but it also had 3D printing, AR, VR, IoT, blockchain, AI, so drones, etc. So thanks to my consulting experience in Germany and working for incubators, which basically means you help 20 businesses get off the ground in 6 months. So you get a lot of experience in a lot of industries, and your job is to help them make their business successful. So yeah, and just for those who don't know what incubators are, like Sam Altman, the CEO of OpenAI, he was the president of Y Combinator, an incubator, before he became like OpenAI CEO. So yeah, there is definitely some value there to be around these enterprise nebulas where stars are being born. So you get exposed to a lot of these crazy ideas, and then being around universities, you get exposed to philosophers and writers, and yeah. So I guess I've been blessed in that way. Sorry, I wasn't able to answer your question about Mad Hatter. So,
no,
yes,
okay.
Of course. So, Mad Hatter Foundation is at its core. So that's our mission, that's our vision, Industry 4.0. There are three things that we focus on. One of them is blockchain, which blockchain technology is something that in a previous life in Germany, I've written an encyclopedia on this, something like 150 words or something. It's linked in the Mad Hatter Foundation. Half of the book is there. So if you click madhatter.technology and just, you know, I'm sure you'll figure out where to find it. And that's not to like flex or anything, but just to show you the amount of knowledge that you have to know about a field to write about it in with simplicity as well, you know. So it's to, and the reason why you will find all of the material that comes from Mad Hatter to be very almost like a high school science book or something, you know, that's how the visuals are. It's very simple. There's a lot of negative space. The whole point is not to waste anyone's time. And the point is to explain all of these concepts from blockchain, from IoT, from AI to people from the ages of 8 to 80. Like, they should all get it, you know, short of memory issues or something, like 8 to 80. It should be accessible. That's what we believe. And in that, our biggest focus and our biggest project right now, because the IoT stuff and the blockchain stuff are things that I brought here from previous projects that I was working on, knowledge that was brought to the organization. But as far as execution is concerned, currently we are 100% focused on AI filmmaking. And with our biggest festival being AI Film Festival. And what we do is we offer AI film studio services. So we are essentially an AI film studio. We have a couple of sound people. We have a very talented team of filmmakers and people with various kinds of sort of artistic backgrounds. And what we do is corporations and companies come to us, and in return and in exchange for working for with us, they help cross-subsidize. So their trainings help pay for trainings that we conduct for free in parallel. So for every corporate, we will conduct a parallel training with an indigenous tribe. So Green Hackers, exactly like that. It's very on point, very on brand. And the thing is that I did my master's in anthropology, and I spent a long time with the Kalasha tribe in the Hindu Kush region. It's one of the last Indo-Aryan tribes to survive in that region. And it's 3,000 people who believe in a religion older than Hinduism, older than the Greek religion. They live high up in the mountain. They're surrounded by Afghanistan and Pakistan, yet they brew their own wine. Their women are free to marry whoever they want. Whereas in the south, if you go towards India, then, you know, like down south in the plains, you know, people commit honor killings. You know, you go down south towards the plain, and I'm referring to all of it as historic India, because Pakistan used to be India. So by that I mean plains versus mountain people, not countries as they exist today. So in the plains, you have honor killing and things like that. You have acid. The husbands throw acids on their wives because they suspect them of cheating. And that is the documentary that Pakistan's first Oscar winner, the first Oscar winning documentary of Pakistan was exactly on about that, the acid victims of Lahore, by a Pakistani filmmaker. So anyway, my point is that for me, it's really incredible to have this tribe survive and to observe and study their social structures. And also there's something very ancient about this knowledge that seems to have been passed down unbroken thanks to how high the mountains are and how rough the terrain is and how the mountain passes close for 6 months. So they remain preserved in a snow globe in time. And as I lived there, I realized that all of these children that seem to be roaming around in that valley, they no longer respect the stories of their elders, which I listen to with so much fascination. And anthropologists and sociologists from Greece and France all spend extended time here. People write papers about it. And yet the children, all that they find fascinating is the TikTok and Instagram videos that they could see. Or in that time, there was no cell phone connection. So at that time, it was Bollywood. You know, and Bollywood, for those who don't know, the way I refer to it is hyper-commercialized. There are some good parts of Bollywood as well. Aamir Khan is a very good example. He is known, notable, established, and mainstream. That is high art. But everything else seems to be hyper-commercialized with very little originality and focus on being high art in any way. So, there is this flashiness and this commercialization, this bling all in your face, sort of through, and it's not just Bollywood, it's also the same thing with Hollywood. The question that it's the same thing with Instagram. The point is, they're seeing something on their screens. No hate intended to any one of these individual sort of, you know, places. I'm not saying they're the problem. Again, what I'm trying to say is the things that these indigenous kids children see on their phones, it inspires them. It's so flashy, it's so blingy, that it makes them disrespect their elders and their elder stories, and they're not interested. It doesn't catch their attention anymore. So slowly, the intangible heritage of the elders that has passed down unbroken, this is the generation where the chain breaks. And so what we want to do at the Mad Hatter Foundation is use their cell phones of these tribes to tell their own stories to them, using their own shamans as first directors to their own stories, where we are assistant directors to them. And instead of us being like, hey, look at this refugee, look at this poor refugee, look at their sad story, I'm a white person telling you this sad story of this refugee, instead of that, it's going to be the refugee telling their own story themselves. And that's what we're trying to enable and empower them to do. Again, no hatred to white people, it's just that generally these industries are located in those areas. And, you know, that's where people respect intangible heritage and stuff and these kind of stories. So that's us in a nutshell.
Wow, man, that's incredible story. I think every project focused on like do good has so much beauty and power behind it, like naturally, you know. So yeah, congrats, really, really admirable and really interesting. And the idea, I think, is great, you know. Everybody complaining about technology, you just get the technology and power the people correctly and they will do good, you know. They will create something that is new and still represented their culture and everything. So yeah, amazing, man, amazing. Following a little bit on that note, you also are the co-founder of the Conceptualizers project, right?
Yes. This is what I was referring to in Germany, the consultancy that I co-founded, where I tried to make the music instruments, the expressive music instruments that are no longer knobs and faders. So that's what I attempted there. I tried to make a meditation device there, which were both hardware products, a meditation device that isn't your cell phone, that is sort of like with a black and white screen, which is mostly like a sonic journey. And it's generative, you know. So before generative AI, it's kind of like how do you call it, granular synthesis, and you use all these other techniques to sort of achieve this ambient meditative kind of thing. And as you meditate every day, so it was also like a smartwatch. It would keep a check on how you're breathing and how your heart rate is relaxed. And if you would use it to meditate, and it would give you these soundscapes, then you get points in this game of gamified version of meditation, where you unlock sound, where you unlock more sensors and more things inside this device. Where you, when you bring fire next to it, now that you've meditated for a month, now you've unlocked the fire thing, and now whatever soundscape is playing in it to meditate that you're meditating to, it will respond to sound, it will respond to light. Or you unlock different features in it, now you've unlocked the granular synthesizer. So it was sort of like, but without the complicated terms, you know, letting everyone sort of trip themselves out on music and just, you know, tweak some things, but still make it sound nice without, you know, giving, yeah. So this was Conceptualizers, and we did a couple of blockchain projects. So Conceptualizers was blockchain and IoT and ESG. So ESG is the kind of stuff that I did, you know, with the sustainability and social enterprise stuff. So yeah, for me, I've been in the field of social enterprise since 2011. So that stuff is like on the back of my hands. And what happened was that in Pakistan, a poor country, you need a concept like social enterprise where you have a lot of these problems. What started happening in Germany, interestingly, when I showed up, was that social enterprise was a brand new concept in Germany when I showed up, because just as new as it was in Pakistan in 2009, in 2017, because the social structure the graph of the pyramid, there are too many people on the pension. So the future generations, as they get older, they won't get the same pension or the lifestyle as the ones before them because the pyramid is wrong. Like in our countries, like I don't know, like in the South, in the global South, Brazil, Africa, South Asia, you have these pyramids where the youngest people are more than 50% of the population. So the German social welfare state was on the verge of collapse, or is, and their solution for this was to import the idea of social enterprise quietly so that they can sort of privatize some of these social services which previously the state was providing with tax money. So that's how I became involved in that. But, you know, it's interesting and all, but to work in a developed country in the developing sector or in the social sector is a very different experience, and it's not exactly why I got into it. You know, like I didn't get into it for bureaucracy. I got into it for the tribes, for the people, being in the villages, smelling the cow dung, you know, all the good stuff. So
really, really nice. I don't know if you know, or also if people know, but the Green Hackers also start as a blockchain project, an NFT project, when I was working for Bankless DAO as well. And we were also co-creating it with some tribes of indigenous in Brazil. So they also were helping with like with the drawings of the NFTs. And also we even shot some short documentary inside this, it's called Funio tribe in Brazil. And because inside the tribe, they had like a filmmaking crew, like three guys, and I had a friend that connect me to them, so we shot this short film of there. But this, yeah, so then the NFT project in the end didn't happen, but our idea was to make some profits also and donate like biggest part of it to the indigenous communities, like this, like ONG, so they will distribute the money for the people who like really need, because we don't know, right? Mm-hmm. But it was important for us to co-create as well with them, also with the story of the project, and I hope that bring this in some way back. But was very interesting project. And talking about this, I would like to talk about skills. So how should like and when, just like as you were saying about community as well, social projects. We also soon are going to open this online courses in Brazil. So we want to teach filmmaking for or kind of like in Portuguese as well, and create content in Portuguese, but basically like educational content about a generative art in general, not just about filmmaking, but for South America. So in Portuguese and in Spanish, probably that's something we are currently working on already, and soon we'll have like first stuff. And yeah, but I would like to talk about skills. So why, like, how should creative education adapt to this like rise of AI? I think we are on the middle of this big shape, and I think the skills that you need will also change. Even like before, we didn't have social media. Now you have social media managers, social media strategy, etc., etc. And we know this AI also bringing a lot of new stuff. So what skills will be, on your opinion, what skills will be the most valuable for the future of like artists and creators?
Adaptability, lifelong learning. I'm a social science major. I can make you a microcontroller control smartwatch. There is no limitation. The beautiful thing about this is that ChatGPT and all of these new technologies can really, like when YouTube came, all of us owe some amount of tuition fee to YouTube, really. You know, the ads, they're like, that's okay. You can take my ads, you can take my subscription, but we really owe almost a university tuition fee amount to what we learn on YouTube. I mean, you know what I'm trying to say. So
YouTube is a big open university. You can learn at least the basics about anything you want. Of course, you need to go deeper at some point, but like the basics, you can learn. I see it as like a free open university. I took like many classes of like Yale or Harvard, like free open classes recorded on my living room in Brazil. And I was like, how cool is that? Like, I will never be able to be there, but there is some classes here where I can learn. And yet, but a lot of people don't realize that still, that YouTube's like a brief, free public punk university in some way.
For sure. And now with ChatGPT, this is also going to sort of the pace at which we can learn new things, it's exponentially increased. And we have to sort of, it's a bit like jazz. We have to play it by the ear, and we have to improvise as we go along, because now we're in uncharted territory. Because I don't think you and I can fully fathom the speed at which this thing that we're interacting with casually processes and thinks. I don't think any attempts that we make to sort of, what I mean to say here is that using this tool that is extremely fast, extremely adaptive, can help you in any way, this can be the ultimate tutor. So there, and when I say lifelong learning, YouTube was just like, you know, in the previous iteration of the internet. This new iteration of the internet has this assistant co-pilot coach, which can basically teach you to make whatever you want. And so your wildest of dreams and fantasies can come true. The craziest thing that you ever wanted to do and study, you can now just do in your free time, or learn in your free time, or come close to it somehow. And before the world of social media, for instance, people like you and me, us conversing with each other, this was a bit harder, right? I mean, a couple of guys in Prague, a couple of guys in Amsterdam, very locally connected. How would we get in touch with each other before the internet or before social media? How would we find each other? It, like, as people who have common interests. So yeah, in that way, I think it's going to completely revolutionize the way we do pretty much everything, the way websites did, and everyone has a website now. So you will never have a website foundation or a website company. And similarly, everyone has an app now. So you can't be a website app foundation or app company or app.com, because that makes no sense. Similarly, AI, the way I see it, is going to be exactly like that. And there are some very good academic charts about academic papers that are written over time. And it predicts this, because it's the same kind of graphical pattern for apps and websites. So basically, everyone who's trying to make their name right now, saying, oh, AI, AI this, AI that, world's first AI, AI, AI. Soon after Microsoft and Apple and Google get together and get their own AIs, everything is going to have AI. The word AI is going to be meaningless, because everything has it, you know, just the way everything has algorithms, you know, and algorithms are in everything. So apps, everyone has a website. So yeah, I think just the word AI and being associated like this kind of hype, of course, it's justified. It's going to transform things and everything. But we need, even people who are phrasing themselves as, hey, I'm going to teach you how to be an AI filmmaker, we also need to think a few steps in the future. You know, what happens in this world where WhatsApp allows people to make the same AI films that we're making now? What happens in this world when people have it this accessible? Every Instagram post has a built-in runway, Gen 2, 11 Labs, whatever, and it's even faster, even better. Then what are we? So yeah, again, going back to that, we need to be extremely adaptive. We need to improvise. It's a bit like jazz. You gotta switch up the tone when you hear the drummer play faster, you know, something like that. So yeah, we'll have to see. And the opportunity is incredible to learn anything that you want, like never before. Back when I was programming these microchip and these controllers for these little device experiments, I needed another human who knew coding in order to actually get what I wanted, you know, as a UX or idea person. I was entirely dependent on someone. Now with ChatGPT, I don't need any of those people anymore. I can actually ask ChatGPT to write that code for me, and et voila. As a person with a lot of ideas, this has really empowered me, basically, is what I'm saying. And with a backlog of interesting ideas that I would have loved to try but couldn't, because I didn't know programming, I couldn't draw. Now,
same problem. I have always had too many ideas and always hard to find a developer to code them. It's still not there, but I think we are something between. Like, I can already do some basic stuff by myself. But I really dream of when I would just design it and I would just explain it, how it works. This is how it works. I can connect some prototypes there, like, okay, when you click here, you go there. But like, I would just explain, like I would explain to a developer, this is the logic, this is how it works. And then it will, and then the same way, there will be a bug and an error, you would just ask to fix it. It will, okay, it's here, I fix it. But I think we will see even more and more and more ideas and stuff. But I will talk a little about this in the next questions further. Let's talk a bit about the Amsterdam AI Film Festival. So first, why did you decide to create it in the first place? And how is the audience reception and the general public reception to the festival?
Well, the first question was, how did we decide to make the AI Film Fest Amsterdam? Ah, yes. So basically last July, the original idea was to make the world's first AI museum, where we, I'm not going to go into more detail because, you know, you can still go ahead with that. The idea started off with an AI museum where we have, I'll give you a little bit, all the way from hardware to software to everything sort of just lying there, because we kind of take for granted how much goes into exactly what we are using on this final product. So how much like from the silicone, which is the most common substance found on Earth, the amount of processing power and everything. So I wanted to make like a miniature version of all the way from ASML's chips, starting with sand, going with these lithography things, all the way to NVIDIA, all the way to Amazon Web Services, all the way. So you can just visualize it. And
infrastructure and the hardware that enables the...
And then right at the end of the installation in the museum or in the rooms or stuff, you have like a person on a cell phone or in front of a television, you know? And it's all one continuous sort of like one long corridor where you experience the entire thing. And then it really makes you realize, holy, you know, like, wow. The idea started with an AI museum. I was already discussing it with my previous co-founders last summer in June, July. And from that, it kind of evolved into AI Film Festival. The reason why we went for AI Film Festival, it's, the story is a bit like The Matrix, you know. The Wachowskis at the time made The Matrix as a proof of concept, so that their financier would give them money for the real project that they wanted to make. So Matrix was the side project to prove that they could make the real project that had money. So AI Film Fest Amsterdam is our Matrix. It might take off and do way better than what we originally set out to do, which is the indigenous filmmaking project. To find money for that is much harder. And that's more of a passion project. That's more of a charitable project. In order to finance the operations of that project, we needed something that allowed us to leverage all the players in this industry. So all the tech players that we have in this industry, and also bring together all the academics in this industry and have a place, because we saw that Runway had a film festival, but if it's Runway's film festival, then Pika will never participate on a panel there, or Pika will never be showcased there or work from Pika. And why not? Runway's film festival existed, but it was mostly a screening event and maybe one panel discussion event separately from everything else, but mostly screening. Other events that I saw around the world, including AI Film Fest Dubai and stuff, again, mostly screening. We realized that there was something missing in the world, which is a place right in the middle of Dubai and New York, right in the middle, where we can combine all the people from the East and all the people from the West and have a true international annual film festival that has panel discussions where people talk, you know, where we hear professors and thought leaders and industry professionals and techie people all come together, and artists raising these questions and saying, you're taking my jobs away, and us having a lively debate around this, right? Like, of course, this is what democracy and all of this is about. And if it affects all of us, we all deserve to ask these questions. We are all stakeholders in this shared future. This technology is too big for any company to call it just their own. And that's the charter OpenAI started off with. So, and like open meaning open source. I'm just saying that that's what we believe in now. And yeah, so AI Film Festival was born out of the necessity to finance our indigenous projects that do not make money. It was born out of the need to make a film festival that was not controlled by one of the top five competitors in this field, so that all five of them have a level playing field to perform at. And it was born out of the necessity to, because our promise is not just a film festival. We're not just a film festival. When you buy our ticket or when you come to our film festival, then you leave a filmmaker. That's the promise. You come in, we give you the subscriptions, we give you the masterclasses. During the masterclass, you will animate your first few seconds of generative AI visuals. And if you have enough of those together and stitch together some music, there you have your very first iteration of an AI music video. There it is. Make three of those 4 second clips in our masterclass, put it up on our social media, put it up on your social media, tag us, and we will send you free credits for Leonardo.ai and Eden.art and Unstable Diffusion or Civit. So yeah, that's the plan. The plan is to get people in. The idea is, our slogan is democratizing filmmaking. And in this, we have faced some resistance, of course. There are some people who like thinking that they're specialists, who like thinking that they're special and they deserve media attention and all of this just because they are film AI filmmakers, and that's very special and it's the first time in the world and all of this. And every news media agency should talk to me. I am the original filmmaker. I am the one. Who are you? Everyone can't be a filmmaker. You can't promise everyone to be a filmmaker after that. Not everyone is an artist, you know. So there are people who I meet on, you know, in my interactions, who are kind of threatened. Like, I feel some of the people that I interact with are genuinely threatened by how everyone can now express themselves creatively, and they find their own position or identity under question. And this is a very strong sort of thing to question, you know? Like, if you spend 30 years, in the stock market, and then Bitcoin shows up, then of course you hate Bitcoin because
I remember a similar story with the photography, when every smartphone starts to have a camera, and then Instagram. I use Instagram in the very beginning, right? So then you basically take a like very bad photo, and then you put a filter, it looks a bit better. But then like everyone was kind of telling that they are a photographer, right? Mm. And I think it's and then I think also photographers were very uncomfortable with that because they study so much and they know so much the technique is, and people are just clicking with their phones, putting a filter and calling themselves a photographer, right? And I think it's a bit similar story, but again, like having the brush doesn't make you a painter, right? Having the camera doesn't make you a photographer, and knowing how to animate sequences doesn't make you a filmmaker. So
true, absolutely true. I was gonna observe that I've seen people with extremely expensive equipment and extremely expensive cameras, huge musical setups. I see their output and what they make in terms of the music or whatever doesn't resonate with me, and I feel like they wasted their money. I've made 5 albums, 49 tracks on Spotify. The total amount of money that I spent on making those tracks, the equipment that I used for it, was €80 and an Ableton trial subscription that I never got a cracked version of or a full version of. I just stayed with the 8-track restriction and I ran with it, and I've got 50 tracks now. So the point is that, and that was my entire investment that got me to my goal. So yeah, again, with your point, it doesn't matter how good your camera is, but I've also seen something funny. So I've also seen people that I've known who identified themselves as photographers, who have a DSLR at home, it's really good, but still choose, you know, because of the screen, because of how good the screen of the phone is, how the screen is just much better than a DSLR screen. So the end result that they see in the moment in their phone is just so much better and rewarding and satisfying that almost the DSLR doesn't need to be taken out anymore. It doesn't give the same immediate satisfaction. And that might be the case with this technology as well. That we get a bit, I mean, people will complain at first, but then, you know, if Adobe has AI, then pretty much everything will have AI in it, right? Like some of these foundational softwares just need to incorporate it, and there it is. It's mass adoption. It's like
it's happening already, right? There will be Sora and Runway inside Premiere, and
But yeah, it's an interesting time to be alive for sure. But yeah, coming back to your question, AI Film Fest. I hope I answered your question. Is there anything else?
No. Yeah, we can talk a bit more about later. But it's nice this. I think it's nice this learning aspect and the workshops and the talks and discussions. I'm also organizing this film festival in Prague together here with the Czech Association of AI. There's some local foundation and also some marketing agency here called Ideal. But I also want to bring some like discussions, and also for the jury, I want to have people who know about like traditional cinema, but people who also know about how hard and how to create films with AI and the all limitations we have with consistency in all of this, so we can have this both views for the judgment as well of the films. And yeah, I also like to try to bring transparency. Even maybe if we could put publicly some notes of the, so people can see how the films were evaluated, like things that me as like part of this community miss a bit on the other festivals, I will try to fix on this one, which I have some power to influence and organize.
Of course. Speaking of hearing everything that you said, I did forget to mention, I think, one or two things. So we have some crazy things that we want to do at the festival as well. So as part of the Mad Hatter Foundation, we have Alex, who's part of our team. He's an influencer on Instagram as well. He blew up recently, and he uses Civit AI in his workflow. For those who aren't familiar, Civit AI is just basically like or the kind of stuff, the videos that I'm talking about, is when you take a human video and then you transpose something AI or other like creative elements and put it onto it. And it's not purely generative in the sense that we have text that turn into images that turn into moving images. Rather, it starts with humans and then the AI comes into the picture. You know, it starts with a real video. So what we're doing is we're having a performance on the stage, which is going to be the dancer dancing in front of the screen, and behind the screen we're going to have their own sort of AI sort of avatar dancing in synchrony with them. So it's something that I don't think many people have done at film festivals. It also adds a performance element to the whole thing. We have two performances like this that we're going to have, one screening, one live performance. So yeah, it's exciting.
And there will be also this pop-up on the city or something like that?
Yes. So on the 21st of June, we have our main event at the AI Film Museum, which is what I was referring to, where we're going to have the performance. It is the biggest cinema in one of the most beautiful buildings in Amsterdam. It is like the Sydney Opera House of Amsterdam, or the Oslo Opera House of Amsterdam, if you're familiar. It's absolutely beautiful, white gleaming building, an architectural marvel. You can see the whole city skyline and the IJ River, and we'll get to see the sunset that particular day. We have the space booked out, so even up till 11 a.m. at night, so even after the festival is over, the plan is to just hang out right outside. We're going to have some food. We're going to have some drinks. We're paying 50 euros per person for like food and drinks. It's criminal, so please show up. It's really going to be worth your money. And we can't give you more than 50 euro discount for that reason, so please don't hate us. But you're going to be eating all of that, and you're going to get 300 euros of subscription, so please show up, especially if you're interested in the AI film community. We have something interesting that you mentioned, the pop-up. It's actually the day one of the festival now. It's going to happen at the world's first AI art gallery. This is how they brand themselves. It's called Dead End Art Gallery, and basically they have physical gallery exhibits of AI art on canvas and on different materials. So we're going to have Shy Kids, an Airhead 1 and 2 screen there, and Shy Kids will answer some questions about what it is like to use Sora. So yeah, that's just a little bit, and just a little bit more, we have some people in the Civit AI, which is one of our sponsors, their creators program, who has made 20 volume graphic novel that was generated, you know, like a 20 volume, like a massive physical piece of work that we're going to have there, like either at the gallery or on the iPhone museum. So some interesting, very innovative kind of things. Yeah.
Really cool. We're looking forward.
Awesome. Yeah. Make sure some food is vegan for me. Yeah, man, I think this technological part of innovation that you're bringing with both AI and all the IoT things you work together is super interesting. So I'd like to touch a little bit more of that, both in filmmaking and in music and audio production. So like what you see as in the future to be the enabling power of AI to be on these areas, like what new things that you can imagine that can be done that could not be done before on filmmaking and on music, and especially in the area of music and audio, like how you think AI can really help the musician to create things instead of create things for him, like the actual tools that we have.
I'm trying to remember exactly the name of the device I'm referring to, but Google, I think three, four years ago, made this device that they released from their music lab. It was, I think it's called N-Synth or something. Let me just... anyway, I forget the name, but it was a screen where you had a touch screen and it could go to four corners of the screen, and if it went to N-Synth or something, I think that's what it's called. I'm unsure, but please correct me if I'm mistaken. So it was AI powered, and you could use your hand and go to the corners of the screen, and on this corner it sounded like a violin, on this corner it sounded like a theremin, on this corner it sounded like a santur, and on this corner it sounded like a synth. And it was the same note or the same melody playing, but the devices would change. And when you came to the center of two of those instruments, then you could hear a weird new instrument in between the two. So my answer is, I'm interested in the weird new in-between instruments that we can now make with this crazy sound like genie. And yeah, I mean, as musicians, we always enjoy new ways of warping sound. So what I'm most excited about doing is to prompt using text prompts, modular synthesis, for instance. And when you look at Ableton, then you have these crazy like modular synthesis programming nodes and stuff that you have to like effects going into this and then that. And then, you know, you have to connect everything in the latest Ableton. It's almost like visual programming. But forget the visual part, it is programming. And all of that can be said in language to an extent. Make that higher, make the cutoff there, add a sidechain there, sidechain it to the beat, add another track underneath, increase the octave, lower the octave for the other one, add Supermassive's reverb, you know, like Supermassive's reverb is great. No, the other one, you know? Imagine if you were hearing like it happening as you're saying that.
Yeah, just direct the computer like a studio producer that will direct an engineer, basically.
And it saves me hours, and I still get to hear the result. I love it. But then there's the part that is like Udio or Suno, and there as a musician, I would say I love the process of creating music. I love the process. For me, I don't care if I'm selling it or not because I never sold mine. I have like 4 followers for my music because I made it for myself. I just enjoyed the process of making it. It gave me something and I listened to it over and over, and listening to it again does not compare to the joy of the first time when I was in the process of recording it and when I could mess up one beat or one thing and then I had to play it all over again just to nail that entire like sequence, because I don't use Ableton to lay my tracks. I actually set everything up and then record it as a live performance for all of my tracks, or at least like 90% of them. So in that moment when I would be performing it, in all those imperfections and mistakes and everything, that process, that back and forth, pressing the wrong button, these mistakes and these, there are hundreds, if not thousands, of micro choices we make as creators.
It's the process, right? I think it's like even design. Like design is the process, not the solutions, not the final website. It's the whole process that you went through to get there. And the idea is that when you change your mind and you take reference or you see something on the way, and same with music, you listen something comes to you. I think for me, it's art in general is more about the process than the outcome, like the motivation, the joy, and the sublimation, the expression, all of this.
But there, I fear that we might lose something. See, so as a musician, and of course, you know, like I'm not saying this as AI Film Festival or something, but you know, as a musician, to have a full song generated completely by AI, and then when I think about the future, and of course, this is like something that we'll all have to think about as we go forward. But when I think about the future, I fear. And of course, it's not good to fear, but I foresee, I guess, that the next generations will, if they're lazy, then they might, there's a danger that they might lose the ecstasy and pure joy of just creation for the sake of creation. When you're not selling it, when you make a director's cut just for yourself, the one that you don't sell or you don't compromise on, that. And all the micro decisions and the number of hours it takes and how tired of it that you are. You don't want to see it anymore. And then you watch it a couple of weeks later or days later with fresh eyes, or you listen to it with fresh ears, and then you're like, wow, it gives me goosebumps. And they're never going to get to experience that journey. They're always going to get results now. They're never going to want to, you know, they won't need to. And that's what I fear, that this because for me that was the most the sweetest kind of ecstasy I've ever experienced, and it's the sort of thing that I can do for the rest of my life, and just sort of the rest of,
yeah. But I think you don't apart, I think, you know, also trying to make an, I understand what you're saying, but thinking about analog photography, for example, right? Like it's like who does analog photography today? Just people who really enjoy it artistically, or right, like you don't need to, but you still have people who do that. Of course, the minority, most people take photo with your phone, because, but like I also see this, like I don't think there will be this total replacement in the same way we still have paintings on the walls and analog photography and normal film and all this stuff, but yeah, I think for who does analog photography today is just people who really enjoy it, the process and the equipment, the revelation process, all of this, right? And I think the music will be similar. Like, who will make music? Like, you can go to Sun Prompt, Spotify, right? You will go to Spotify. I want, instead of doing a playlist for you, like they are already doing, they're choosing the songs by your description. They will make the whole songs in 3 seconds. Like, or even you listen the first 5, they will be making the other 20 already. So like it will be, and I like, but
yeah,
who will like make music is just people who really enjoy the process and the craft and they feel the music, the sound and all this.
I mean, like just picking up on what you say, with Spotify, a lot of artists and creators, including Taylor Swift, had a huge problem with how much they pay their artists. And speaking of that, musicians, our CDs and stuff used to sell for like 20, 30 euros or something before record CDs. And the royalties that in the end per track sold or per user, per person, were huge for musicians. Now the musicians are getting cents on the dollar for the same tracks that they're making. And what happened was that the industry just and the customers just decided to ignore them, the artists in the middle. And so their profit margins declined very heavily. And now what I see happening is even further, like there is going to be very little money in being a commercial artist of visual or music form. I don't know, because I mean, I'm just thinking about it. I worked for a marketing agency, and when I walked down the halls of that marketing agency now in my memory 10 years ago, I walked down the halls and I see the graphic design department and the 20 guys sitting there, or the 20 people sitting there, and it's empty because all of that is a 10 euro subscription now. I walk past the copywriting and creative department, and that's just a ChatGPT subscription now. And soon the accounting department will just be a super Google OpenAI's new Google sheet or whatever, OpenAI sheet. And that's it. The accounting department's closed too. And if you've seen DevChat, I don't know, have you had a chance to see DevChat? So DevChat is basically you make lots of little chat GTPs or like agents. They all talk to each other. You assign them roles. You say you're the CTO, you're the CEO, you're the quality department, you're the error checker. And in the end, they give you working code of a working game. It can make you Flappy Bird. You give it a prompt, and it's a whole company that will have lots of conversations amongst each other and have assets that they build, including visuals and graphics, and make you workable code. And there's something that I saw recently where you can just, I mean, the point of me saying the dev chat thing is, I foresee a future, and I know it's a bold thing to say, where you only have the board and a CEO, nothing else. Everything else is handled by, in a traditional tech company, all the roles that are there, everything else is a GTP or an agent. That is a future we are going towards, and it's not hypothetical. This is 6 months old, this chat dev thing. Okay, so I don't know how we're going to solve these questions of what happens when the corporations decide that all these subscriptions means a mass layoff of all the intellectual class, you know, like the educated class. This time the layoff is not coming from the blue collar or the miners, or, you know, this time the job losses are coming from the people with university degrees. And that's the interesting part. That's what's different. So I don't know what will happen in the future, but certainly on a positive note, I can say that do I feel less joy when I see a prompt getting nailed? Like, you know, like when I really get it right. Because you can try a couple of times and not get it. And when you're really trying to get into a new project and find a new aesthetic, and you keep generating things, lots of things, experimenting, seeing what other people make. One of the things I love about generative AI is how many ideas I get and how it's so easy to borrow. You can go on anyone's prompt and remix it in most of these apps, right? There's a community, it's open by design, it's public, everyone's supposed to share it. I think this is revolutionary compared to what we had with copyrights and art galleries and these middlemen who gave themselves importance in the process. Step aside, the real person, the hero of the show is the artist, right? That's the point. And now I guess it'll be about prompt mastery and seeing that. But the positive thing that I was saying was that do I experience less joy watching one of these softwares bring to life the thing that I wanted to envision? Does it give me the same kind of dopamine that I would get as making a film? I would say yes. Because you and I are still here, and we're still addicted.
In some way, yes, it's very nice to see the thing that we are, your mind, like bringing to life. And also, when you're an artist, when you're creative, you have this stuff on your mind already. And I think even when you see these famous filmmakers talking about their films, they say like, "I have the film in my mind already. I just need the money and the people to shoot it." Mm. It was the whole film was already here: the photography, the colors, the editing, the pacing. And I think, that's the thing, it's this constant interact, but it's really rewarding when you have an idea, you go there, and in 50 seconds, if you're lucky, maybe on the first prompt, you can get it, and say, "I did." And the thing is, most of the time, say, "Oh, this is exactly what, like, it's very similar to what I had in mind, but this is even better." So then you take it from there, right? So it's this like co-creation process.
Definitely, definitely.
All right, we are approaching the end, so we have like two more questions for you. Just to finish, I think you said that you make some music videos, so you're also AI filmmaker, right? So, how do you enjoy the process of creating it? Which kind of films you create with AI? And yeah, can you talk a little bit about it?
Yes, there's a film called Amsterdam Jack. It's on 01 Sign. You can look at it over there. It's one of the films that I made. Of course, it's not entered in the film festival or it doesn't have anything to do with it. It's just a passion project, really. One of the things that, just like you said, I always wanted to do it. I always wanted to have a gritty film noir. It's the stuff that I've grown up on. Frank Miller, Samurai Champloo, Cowboy Bebop, the anime. You watch the stuff and it's just, you know, the music is a vital part of the whole story. So, like, that's why I'm telling you about Samurai Champloo and Cowboy Bebop. And because these two animes, the storyline and every visual aspect in it, in both of them, has the genre of the music built into the story and the visuals. So Cowboy Bebop is about bebop jazz with cowboy bounty hunters in space. That is the whole prompt that we would give to make that. And then Samurai Champloo is hip-hop. Hip-hop samurai fusion in feudal Japan, that's the prompt for that. But hip-hop is part of the whole story, the entire editing and the entire visual aesthetic of that show. So similarly, my idea here was taking inspiration from that, and I wanted to keep it very trip hop, kind of jazzy, detective story of a sort of a guy who, you know, in this traditional 1950s, some people might call it chauvinistic or whatever. Why do the ladies not have any dialogues? But it's just trying to stay true to a trope or to a subgenre. And it's a monologue. It's what's going on inside a person's head, how they're thinking, how they approach the world. And it's inspired by the fact that I was a very quiet child and I had an internal monologue. I would, you know, there are videos of me standing like this in 1999 in France at a zoo. I'm 9 years old and I'm like, you know, like an old man staring at the sea after he's lived his life. So anyway, a monologue is something that always really appealed to me. I also have an internal monologue. I identify with the character. Damsel in distress, that's something that I've always I can't resist, whatever the reason for that is. But if a lady is in trouble, I like, it's called it chivalry, call it whatever you want, but I'm gonna step up twice as hard to sort of help. It has that in there. And then also the femme fatale, a very interesting concept, which is a strong female lead that leads to the destruction of the hero because of his weakness, whatever that weakness may be. So all of this is like a story, almost like of a tragic love story, of a guy who gave his heart to the wrong person. He got hurt for it in the end. And I think that's something, boys, girls, whoever you want, we can all relate to that. We all have a monologue. So yeah, that's a little bit about that. What kind of work went into it? It's 6 minutes long. It has 100 animated shots in it that are 4 seconds each. What else? I made 300 animated shorts in total, 200 failed generations, 100 successful ones. I used a custom GDP to build the whole thing, where this is, I made this in November, so all the character consistency and the style consistency was achieved using a custom GDP. And all I said was, next slide or next page or next scene or make it in space. Now they're in front of the canals. And that's all I had to say. And it gave me everything, poop, 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 because I programmed it correctly at the top. it's working smart. So yeah, it was in terms of the images, it was 600 images, 300 failed, like total gens, 100 successful gens, and then putting it all together. And I know you're gonna in a quick fashion, because of course, as my team reminds me, this is not my job. My job is to run the festival. It's not to make films, and you know, I should be signing deals, making partnerships, and all of that stuff. So this is just what I do in my free time over Christmas. So yeah.
That's awesome, and that's really great. I'm a huge, big fan of like musical based cinema. Especially anime, so big fan of Cowboy Bebop and Samurai Champloo. You know, if you watch Back, is another musical anime. It's super nice, the guitar representation in there.
I haven't seen this. You must send me this the link and stuff after the chat here.
Yeah, it's super interesting. And yeah, man, I think I disagree with your team. I think the fact that you are building AI films and have an AI film festival make you best fit for both, you know? It makes you provide the things that people that are building AI films really want on the festival, and like also seeing what can be done, what resonates with people. So I think it's actually going to a great, great place. So last two questions here for you. Why should people come to the Amsterdam AI Film Festival this summer?
Yes, of course. We have hundreds of submissions from all around the world, from 38 countries. We have 80 or close to 100 submissions from 21 countries in Europe. Most of the people from Europe that have submitted to us are coming to the AI Film Festival. We have offered them all free tickets. 100 of the tickets are reserved at a 70% discount for university students, because of course, their students, 50% discount for artists. Write to us on Instagram or email us, and for industry partners, etc. The non-artist people who have a job who can afford to pay, 20% discount. This is basically what we're offering. The reason why I mentioned all of these demographics, who are we reaching out to, who are the people that are coming, we have 500 museums in the Netherlands and an equivalent amount of art galleries in just Amsterdam. So we are reaching out to galleries, museums, not just in Amsterdam, but also in Germany, in Netherlands, Luxembourg, etc., you know, working out in a radius all throughout Europe, because we assume at such a short notice, those are the people who will be able to pay and come. So that's our target, that's our market. We are very international, we're very global. If you come to our festival this summer, you will learn how to be a filmmaker. If you come in, you have no idea and you just know natural language, after a few of our masterclasses, you will be making the kind of superb visuals that you see on our own Instagram, for instance. So we encourage you to please follow us. The festival is on the 20th at the Dead End Art Gallery from 12 to 6 in the afternoon, Amsterdam time. And the main event takes place with the award ceremony at the 21st of June at the biggest, most grand cinema at the Eiffel Museum. We have the place till 11 o'clock at night, and the shelter is right next door where we can go for an after party. So it's a very nice offering. People are coming from Sydney, people are coming from California, people are flying in from all around the world. We have influencers on our panels and our team and our judges, who all in total have 700,000 plus followers with 30 million plus views. Really cool people, really passionate about the work, filmmakers from all around the world. It's going to be a little nerdy when it comes to the panel discussion and the networking, for sure. Because I feel like after looking at the submissions, there are very few of us in our respective countries, you know? So it's good to sort of congregate every once a year, like a pilgrimage, you know, and get a chance to see each other physically and have some fun. So yeah, we have food for you, worth the entire money of the ticket, food and drinks. So please, all you need to do is write to us and show up, and you'll get your discount. So yeah,
that's amazing. I will be there, or they will be there for sure, representing everyone's cine. So we also invite everyone to come to the festival, say hi to us, and like have a great chat. And yeah, man.
About that, I wanted to say that we're partnering with 01 Sign, and Odair is going to be on our panel discussion as well, and we're going to be exhibiting some films from 01 Sign at the first day of the film festival, which is on the 20th at the Dead End Art Gallery. So yeah, looking forward to see you there.
Yeah. Really cool. We are looking forward. Yeah, and if you're hearing this, if you're doing AI films, come. It's always, I'm also pushing the people that I know virtually on Twitter that are in Europe at least to come so we can have a beer, we can talk and straight up these connections. It's very nice to meet people in person. And also, again, this community is a lot of nerds, a lot of smart people, talented people, creative people, people who are sharing what they know, sharing their prompts, like you're saying. So I think it's very special community. And it's very nice how we share everything we know and how we learn with each other every day, kind of.
For sure. And it's broader than that. So it's not just the people who are like super experts of AI filmmaking. There's like 100 of them. But then the rest of them are people who are writers and poets and musicians and photographers and animators and people who had a small credit at the back of a film or worked in a studio like in some other capacity, who now see this technology and are using it as an opportunity to self finance, you know, that project. And the way I put this is that Wes Anderson, one of my favorite directors, Wes Anderson needed a certain amount of money to finance his first short film, which was Bottle Rocket, right? So he needed some money. Without that financier taking a chance on him, he wouldn't be able to hire the actors, get the locations, get the equipment, get the set, show everyone that he has that kind of aesthetic and artistic vision. Today's Wes Andersons have the ability to prove, to show the rest of the world their aesthetic without any budget, without asking anyone for money. And, you know, I think that is extremely wonderful and it reduces barriers to entry. So, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. For me, it's also the best aspect of AI is this democratization of creativity. It's just beautiful, beautiful. For yeah, sure. Man, it was super pleasure of mine and for to have you here, have this super nice chat with you. We'll see you in Amsterdam in a month, more or less. Mm-hmm. And yeah, we always finish with like opening the floor for our guests to share any thoughts or any message you would like to stay with people. So yeah, the floor is ours.
So yeah, I just want to say that I think this is an extremely wonderful opportunity for all of us to, I mean, myself, I can only speak for myself. It has shortened my timeline for my passion dream project of something that I wanted to see come to life by 10 years and by hundreds of hours, hundreds of man hours that we could spend. My brother had an advertising agency, animation agency that he ran in the last 5-6 years. The output that he would generate with his whole team of 6-7 animators and all these PCs working full-time for a week, I can generate that output in 3 hours, 2 hours, 1 hour, a few clicks. The time is only going to get shorter as we move forward. So yes, it's an exciting space. Everyone is welcome. Everyone dreams. Everyone goes to sleep. We want you to dream with your eyes open and see your dreams come to life at the AI Film Fest Amsterdam. So yeah.
Nice. Thank you. Yeah, thanks for your time. Thanks for your words. Thanks for organizing the festival. It was really a pleasant conversation. We hope everyone will enjoy it as we do. And we always finish with a quote to kind of let people inspire when they turn off the episode. You know, you keep this last quote on your mind and kind of tends to reverberate. And if you notice, it also happens when you're listening music on your headphones and then you arrive somewhere at your work or whatever you're going and then you just turn it off. The last music that was playing is the one that will keep in repeat on your brain. Mm-hmm. And once my friend told me, I realized that a few times it's really true. It's always like if you're the ones that stop, it stays there. So that's kind of the goal of this and with this quote. So the quote of today is from Jean-Luc Godard, which is like a famous filmmaker. And quote, cinema is the most beautiful fraud in the world. Quote. And see you next time.